Stand by me. Stand by me. Stand by me.
Good evening and welcome to this special episode of In Conversation with Power TV. Tonight, I am so happy to be in the company of such incredible women for this very important episode hosted by Dawn Butler. Our focus of the conversation tonight will be how, as women, we can teach our children to understand anti-racism in the home and in our communities. Also, how important it is to teach ourselves first so we can lead by example.
Thank you so much, Rosemary. And it's a pleasure to be here with all of these amazing women. And it's great that we're having this conversation. And this conversation is born from watching the brutal killing of George Floyd. And for that 8 minutes, 46 seconds, all of our lives changed. And it's nice to just get a taste from each of the women how your lives changed. And it's a generational trauma. All of a sudden, you remember all of these things, a specific incident that came back. And now, especially women are feeling brave to just speak about it. So it's really wonderful to have, you know, you all here. So I'm just going to quickly run through who we've got joining us today, and then you can all just introduce yourselves. And this is in no particular order. So I'm going to start with Lavinia. Lavinia, do you want to just introduce yourself and tell us what you do and why? And how did it feel? The moment you saw that video, how did it feel?
Hey. Hi everyone, so I'm Lavinia, thank you Dawn. I'm just so excited to just be on this panel with you all. I at the moment I'm running an organisation called The Black Curriculum, which essentially is a social enterprise that works to teach Black history in schools 365 days of the year, so not only in just Black History Month, in order to empower all young people with a sense of identity and belonging, because as we have it, the current curriculum is very Eurocentric and it doesn't center any Black histories at all. And like, that's such a disservice for our young people. And so what we're aiming to do is really provide not only a narrative that is focused on Black histories in Britain, but also working to upskill young people as well. So that's been running for the last year. I'm also a writer. That is my passion. I love to write. My degree was in development and African studies, so I'm also kind of into learning Swahili, and those are my passions and that's my work. So yeah, great to meet you all.
Oh, Swahili, amazing. Say hello in Swahili.
Mimenina tu Lavinia.
Wow, amazing. And I think we're going to come back to you later, because that is core in regards to education and what's needed and how we change going forward. And you've been doing this for many years, so thank you very much. And now everybody's listening, so you're on the right path for a long time, so thank you so much. Sandra, over to you.
Hi everyone, my name is Sandra. I'm just so happy to be amongst so many phenomenal, strong women. So thank you for inviting me again here. I run the Motherhood Group. So it's a social enterprise that connects, supports and encourages Black mothers here in the UK. And we created a platform basically for us to talk about challenging taboo topics that really doesn't get spoken about on an everyday basis. And also when I became a mother of two myself, I realized there was no safe space for a Black mum to kind of, you know, be themselves. And from then, for the last 4 years, we've actually now hosted over 37 events, and we've worked with over 1,200 mothers to kind of build their confidence, not only in the workplace amongst their families, but also across their entire daily lives. So I'm just happy that so far I've been able to impact so many mothers, including myself, to amplify our voices, because I felt personally that my voice wasn't heard when I became a new mom, and I've heard my story echo amongst other mothers in my network as well. When I saw the video of George, my heart literally shattered into pieces. Because I felt like I've been suffocated in, not physically, but mentally and emotionally, by the system, by healthcare services, in the workplace and amongst my daily life. And it's not overt racism that hurts me the most, it's covert, because you can't really pinpoint it and you can't really call it out when you see it. So that video was, it brought back all of my bad memories that I've been through throughout my entire life, and it really hurt. And it was my first time in a long time speaking out openly again about race, because I felt like I had to kind of speak about it in a kind of subtle way. But from that video, it kind of gave me that strength again to kind of push and amplify mothers and my own voice as well.
Thank you so much. And Sandra, you know, five times the rate of deaths of black mothers than their white counterparts. So what you do is absolutely amazing. So thank you so much. And Kimberly, over to you.
Hi, everyone. I'm Kimberly, probably best well known for being a pussycat doll. I'm also an actress and author. I'm also an advocate for dance, and I work with the Youth Sport Trust to bring dance to primary and secondary schools, to sort of arm kids with dance, to bring all cultures together and teach through dance and music, which I feel is so important. Inclusivity. When I saw George Floyd in that moment, it brought a lot of emotions up in me, and it came from growing up in a very racist household and coming up against that time and time again and staying strong within my values. I know that if I didn't have dance to get me out of that situation, I wouldn't have probably had the guts to do it. And dance has taught me so much. It's introduced me to inclusivity in such a major way. And because of my values being so strong within me, I stood up to every situation in every way I knew how. And that means that I feel very alone. I don't have a relationship with my parents because we are so fundamentally different. And so in that moment, it brought up so much in me, because I feel in so many moments when everyone is raising up their relationship with their parents, and I have to say, well, I don't really have one. I feel really judged for that, but yet I don't have a place to have that conversation. So I'm really thankful to be here and to be able to be part of this conversation, because I have a story too, and racism has affected me in such a major way, but a lot of times I don't feel like I am worthy of the conversation because I have white privilege, basically.
Well, you're amongst friends, you're amongst sisters here today, and I mean, we have to come back and talk about, but before I move on, I just want to ask you, how did you find the strength, and at what age did you find the strength, if you grew up in a racist household, not to be racist?
The whole time, like, I always knew in me that it wasn't right. And when it came to actually speaking up about it, I must have been about 14, 15 years old. And especially a lot of alcohol was involved, and it meant going against, you know, cocked back fists and being shoved up against walls and being told that if my friends called, you know, there'd be a shotgun ready. And if I was hanging out with my friends, I'd have to hide if I saw a cop car coming, because they would go straight to tell my father, and I was scared to bits.
Wow, that is pretty phenomenal and amazing. Well, thank you for sharing. We have to come back and talk about that some more. Jenni, over to you, Jenni.
What can I say about me? My name's Jenni. I'm a mum. I'm a grandma, so I have two grandsons. I'm a
grandma.
Yeah, I said that too.
I call myself the energy stealer. So working with young people, I'm able to just take all that energy and stay young. I'm a lot older than I look. I'm about to be 48. I've got three big children, two grandsons. I'm a young person's independent domestic violence advisor. I'm also a sexual violence advisor. I have a diploma in domestic abuse. I run a company that is child sexual abuse, child sexual exploitation. So any of those high-risk young people is the work that I do within schools and for social services. So my journey into that is probably like many women who work in those fields. As a teenager, I was in a violent and unhealthy relationship. There was no support. We're going back to when I was about 17, 18. Support for young girls was non-existent. It didn't happen to our age group. And I told myself that I would come back and create something for the younger version of me. And I fought really hard to do that. And we now have healthy relationship education programs in schools. So I'm still fighting, but we've got our foot in the door.
Good. Well done. And it's absolutely vital because when it comes to gangs, you know, the girls are left out on the outside. They're hardly spoken about, but yet still they're the ones who are abused.
Definitely. Often.
There's lots of gang rape that happens and all that violence that happens. So amazing what you're doing. Thank you so much, Jenni. And Vera, over to you. Thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you for having me. It's such a pleasure to be and have this discussion with all of you. Yes, my name is Vera Ora and I'm a psychiatrist. I work in the community mental health team in London as an NHS psychiatrist. So for me, this discussion is very valuable because I see lots of people that are coming through with enduring mental health problems, including, you know, patients and family members that are supporting our patients that have been going through various discriminatory kind of issues. And I think this is such an important topic that is really kind of making everyone kind of listen. And I think is the time now to try and vocalize and support everybody. Yeah. I am also a minority. I come from Kosovo with three young children. I couldn't speak English. I have to adapt and try and integrate, which was a very long process for me and very stressful. So I fully understand when you feel slightly different and what that means psychologically. And as a mother, the impact can have in your family and in your children.
Yeah. And do you want to say who your famous daughter is, Vera?
Vita Ora is my famous daughter. And I have other two children. And for me, they're not different. But I'm a mother and I'll be a mother. And I consider my children all the same. So, yes, that's her.
I have exactly the right answer.
Thank you.
But absolutely, race is a mental health issue. You know, when you're suffering all of the disturbances that comes with race, whether it's like a microaggression, whether it's like overt or covert, whether it's your parents at 14. So what, tell me the age where you felt it or you fought against it. What age was you when you felt it or fought against it? Racism. Kimberly, you said you were 14 when you kind of realized your parents were wrong.
I spoke up when I was 14, but I knew, I mean, it was always apparent. It was always there from a very young age, and I could silently have conversations in my own head, but finally finding the strength to actually speak up and speak out, I was 14.
And what did your parents do when you spoke out?
Oh, it was mostly against my father, and he was just horrified. He couldn't believe what was coming out of my mouth. I think he felt like I was a traitor of what he felt should be normality, but I couldn't help myself. Like I didn't care what was going to happen to me. My truth needed to be spoken. I felt so passionately about it. I felt, you know, my thing was there's bad people of all different races. It isn't just Black people. And I would say that to him with such tenacity. And as it would become aggression, you know, I would just put my chin out there and be ready. Like, if you need to hit me over this, and like you said, it is a mental health issue. And I could see that within them. And I think the pressures of society and maybe not having the money or not having the company be as successful as he wanted to be, he needed to point the finger at someone or something. And so I felt like it became racism in order to get that aggression out, to feel macho within, you know, being the small guy, really. He needed to blow himself up. And we lived in a town that was still is racist. I mean, Missouri is on the NAACP list as of 2017 to travel at your own risk if you're of color. So the sort of ridiculousness that we lived amongst was so apparent.
Yeah, wow. And Sandra, I saw your face kind of, you were like, wow. How does that make you feel? And what age were you when you thought, well, actually, as a Black woman, this isn't right. I'm going to do something about it.
No, it's just horrifying what I've just heard Kimberly say, you know, living in a household where your parents are overtly racist and having to be so young and fight against that. You're incredibly brave and strong to do that. Myself personally, I grew up in Stockwell, Southwest London. If you know that area, it was very the hood, basically. I'll put that, the hood. And so everyone in my area was black. My mum was Nigerian. You know, I was very much into my culture, my Nigerian culture. And I went to a school and, you know, I had lots of friends that were black and I didn't even know that I was black, you know. I didn't really know what my colour meant until I would say my first open experience of racism was when I travelled out of the UK when I was about 16 years old. And there was this project that I wanted to take part in where you go into a town in America and you do camping or you're a camp counselor for a few months. And I did that and I was so excited to, you know, leave family and friends and do this for about 4 or 5 months. And I went into a place called Rhode Island, a little village, I think, or a town in Rhode Island. And I was told I was the only black person in that area. And I didn't mind until I kind of got treated very, very differently. And I noticed that I was asked the most craziest questions, like, oh, does black people's hair grow? I was asked random things that didn't really make sense to me. You know, people can't swim. I heard they can't swim. Or when I would go into the sun, they would say, don't you want to, you know, get lighter? Why do you want to get darker? And these little words that were said to me when I was on this camp, it really, really was my first experience of feeling like I hated being black. And then I would notice that when they would uplift, you know, people that were black, they looked like Beyonce, you know, they looked slightly more, you know, accepted as lighter or a fairer skin. And I knew that being black and then also being dark skinned wasn't desirable. And then obviously going back to the UK, starting work, I noticed again that my degrees, my qualifications, my experience didn't mean that much. And I knew that I had, and I felt like I had to work 10 times harder than my peers who I could see progress faster and quicker, that wasn't as experienced as me, didn't get as much grades, higher grades than me. And it made me very, I hate to use the word bitter, but quite resentful, knowing that I could have been further up in life if I was just, you know, not black, basically. So that was my first experience. And now I'm teaching my kids that they are black because they're starting to notice it. I've got a 2-year-old and a 4-year-old, and they're when they go on YouTube, you know, all their favorite YouTubers are, you know, blonde hair and blue eyes, and all the dollies in the shops are, you know, blonde hair and blue eyes. There's no black dolls in Tesco's or Aldi's or anywhere, and I have to now proactively make sure that they understand that self-love starts from accepting that you are black and that you are beautiful. And that, look, I even had to create a book called Zoe and Chloe that had black characters. And now I'm very aware that you have to kind of introduce self-love, because otherwise the world will tell you.
Absolutely. You have to love the skin that you're in. Yes. I mean, you cannot let anybody tell you that you're not good enough. You have to love the skin that you're in and know who you are and know how special you are and how proud you are. And actually history teaches that us that. History will teach us that, right?
History tells us that we're not. I think what history says to us in the Eurocentric curriculum is that we come from a lineage of slaves, and it tells us that our heritage is literally like Africa was just a place of darkness. These were the words of like Joseph Conrad and like prolific writers in our history books, English books, and also just with European thought that basically categorized Africa as like beneath and Europe as above. So I think with colonialism and the way that it set us up, it's that our education system prioritizes European ideologies, European thoughts and people as better than. And I think
what is the reality of it? What is the actual reality? So that's the distortion of history. That's the distortion. But what is the actual reality of history?
The reality is that we come from an abundant continent that has a plethora of cultures. It's not just the African continent as one block. And so I get really angry when I see people just like, oh, I'm going to Africa. Where? Which part of Africa are you going to? Because it's so rich and it's so diverse, right? And I think with our history, it goes back, we've had empires, we've had innovators and pioneers who have set the tone for the world as we know it today. And I think history is so key to know that, because you start to and I think even amongst living in Britain, amongst all the kind of sets of oppression that we've had to face over centuries, we've still been able to do things. And I think it's so important that young people know that, and that our history isn't just, it didn't start with slavery, it didn't end there either. And absolutely. I think what we're trying to do with the Black curriculum is like make sure that these narratives are told and taught in a way
What's the most positive word that you would use to describe, like, I've been talking about resilience, you know, like being taught resilience from my parents and knowing that, you know, everything that happened, they got through it and you know, and they rose. So what is the one word for you that you'd say, right, okay, this is it. This is the word that every child needs to know. This is the word that Sandra needs to know, because when she didn't feel beautiful being Black, what would be the word that you would tell her that actually your Black skin is beautiful?
I'd say the word for me, it's determination. Because I think with the way in which we've been presented, it's very passive in history. We look at the things that were done to us, and I think in fact the reality is that we've taken initiative, and we've been the ones who have set the pace. It's such a beautiful thing, because it's about unity, right? It's not just us here in Britain, it's us also in America and the Caribbean and Europe. There are people, Black people in France and Italy, and I think their narratives are also so important. It's about unity.
Absolutely. Determination. So, Jenni, you survived. You're a survivor. You describe yourself as a survivor. You're a survivor. How did you survive? What made you survive? What was that driving force for you?
Do you know what? I just want to add that Kimberly, the strength that comes from you and what you've shared is amazing. For myself, we, as a family, from young, we've always spoken about race. My grandma's white, British, my granddad's Jamaican on one side, and my dad's from Barbados, Windrush. So there's like so much within my family. Most of my cousins, I think my mum was the only child to marry someone Black. All of my aunts and uncles have all married white women or white men. So between myself and my brothers, we are the only full Black grandchildren, and we're talking about 100 and odd grandchildren, because my nan had 13 children. My children couldn't understand why my nan was white and I'm Black. So we've always had to have family tree conversations. So my daughter is darker than me and my sons are my complexion. So again, I've always had that conversation with my daughter about her complexion. And I know that she had a really tough time growing up, going through secondary school, and we would always have these debates about hair, you know, and her wanting to relax her hair, but me saying we don't have to. I've never had to relax my hair, so I had to teach her how to manage her hair. So we've always had that, but now one of my grandsons is of mixed parentage. So again, we're having that conversation, because at my house, I'm Black, he's coming here, he's eating Caribbean food, African food, and he's going home and not. So again, we're still having to have that family tree conversation, and it's a big thing for us to have to do. But I do think that at home, if we come from mixed parentage, it's really important, whether we are in contact, whether the relationship has worked between our children and their separate partners, us as Black women, Black uncles, aunts, uncles, it is important. So, you know, it is a really strong conversation to have to keep on having, but having it happily.
And is that the key? So is that the key to harmony, in a way? That conversation is now changing all kind of loving.
We do have to embrace. My daughter's on her locks journey now as well. Yeah, you know, one of my sons is. So it's like, get them locks, girl, grow them, help that. You know, I think we need to be 100% on that. But I do think that it has to start in the home, but we have to be comfortable. And I think what really kick-started for me was I'd done a Women's Black History course probably like in 2009, 2010. And when I saw these women as queens, and I just had to say, it's time to rewrite everything I learned. Mm-hmm. Everything I learned just stopped that day. And I was like, I need to be as great as these women. I would say that to also encourage that we go and do Black History courses, send our children. If we don't know, then we can always find someone who does, and go and take part in it ourselves as parents, as sisters, aunts, mothers. We should be doing that.
Just how many people, how many of us have cried over the last 2 weeks for one thing or another? Just, I mean, I cried. Yeah. I mean, it's been such an emotional journey, but it is learned behavior. And I don't know how, you know, Vera will talk about the psychology of it, but it's still quite amazing how you get out of it. So how you're proud of your black skin, how you, Kimberly, say, well, actually, I'm not going to be racist like my parents. But then it means that you've now cut your parents off from your life. How does that feel?
I mean, it's horrific. And especially having been through lockdown and you don't have anybody checking in on you, having three children. And, you know, I don't get that phone call. I don't have that foundation. I don't have anyone to call upon. I don't feel that. So then having gone through lockdown, feeling a little bit lonely, and then going into everything that we've been through, it's just heart-wrenching to the point that it's almost soul-destroying. I would wake up every day with such a huge stomach ache. For one, being lonely, but also being like, I just want to make a change. Like, I've been so aware of this and did everything in my power to make a change. And when I knew I couldn't and didn't have the power in myself, you know, I cut and run and did what I felt I needed to. And now I have to pull strength from other areas, whether it's dance or crystals or oils or angel cards or journals or writing or whatever it might be. You know, I've come to a point where I found forgiveness for all those experiences because I don't want to carry that baggage with me, but I still can't forget it, and I still have this fight in me to want to make that change. And I guess one thing I would say is, at least this is now bringing this conversation about, which is, you know, this, I wish it had been done so many years ago, but we needed to see something like this, I think, to wake everybody up into making something happen. And now I'm sitting here watching people, you know, pull monuments down, and I'm feeling elated. I'm feeling like finally something is happening. And it's unfortunate that we have to go to such an extent and not follow the democratic process to get there. But by following the democratic process, these things are happening. So I'm in a place of, you know, I'm just trying to find my power again. And then I think it hit me even harder because I didn't have anybody to call upon. And then I would have friends that were having wellness circles, but only for women of color. And I feel like I've had all this racist upbringing in me. And I've like, but wait, I need to expel that too. So finding where I put myself has been really difficult. But you know what? That stomach ache that I've been holding on to every day, as soon as I knew I had this space to connect and tell my story and finally have that, it's like, okay, now I'm doing my part and I can tell my story and it can mean something and be for good rather than just, you know, feeling like it's torn me down and will continue to tear me down. Mm-hmm. You know, it can be my power that makes me feel proud of the skin I'm in as well.
Well, you've made some friends tonight, Kimberly. Yes. We're your friends now. You can count on us. Teach us how to dance as well. Vera, so how do we... So how the psychology of it, what is it? How do we cope with it? What do we do? What are the things that we have to make sure that our children learn from now to make sure they have this resilience? What is it?
For me, when Dawn, you mentioned a word that comes to your mind, for me personally, as a professional and someone who is seeing the worst case scenario of all what you guys spoke about, there is a worst case scenario. It's awareness. For me, I think it's really important to have this in mind from all the levels within our society, starting from the streets up to the government and services. We have to have this solid awareness that things are still happening. We are facing with discrimination. We can see patients, we can see people suffering as a result. We have now decades of research showing that when people are chronically kind of treated differently and that are unfairly treated or badly, they can as a result suffer in a various levels of mental health. So then what happens is they end up within mental health services, and obviously they're dealing with massive low self-esteem that is really difficult to treat, because then you are looking into the whole holistic approach. And if society is still a fragile place for them, that is very difficult to shift. And then people become very susceptible to anxiety. And anxiety, probably you must have heard or experienced yourself. It's a very crippling condition. Right. For example, I've worked in perinatal mental health in a local massive hospital, and I've seen lots of mothers with young babies. And I can relate to a lot of people here that you're talking about, the children. I had the children, I had to sit with them and talk to them. It's very, very difficult. I mean, and we have to start from when we're pregnant to deal with our emotions. We have to make ourselves understand that the mothers who are pregnant and carrying their babies, it will be affected, and the babies are affected with mothers' emotions. And for example, it's a domino effect. If mum is suffering, or any young person is suffering, especially young women who are, you know, planning to get married and have family, that is the domino effect, because then, you know, that sort of a distress can be carried over, and that will impact how they're raising their children as well. Fragile mom, it's fragile family, it's fragile society. That's why we have to kind of be aware and help and support services who will help young mothers to stand up on their feet despite everything else, give them psychological effect, and telling them where they can get the help and support. And I do work in a high end. I work with people that are sectioned under the Mental Health Act, that need severe treatment. And obviously we're trying to work around not treating them differently.
Yeah, which we know happens in the Black community, that Black people get treated differently and get over medicated.
So we have to be mindful about that sort of a problem. And I know, for example, you know, it's a lot of things that we can do within the public health. Pick up perhaps patient when we do a mental health questionnaire. We ask all sorts of questions. But we don't ask questions, have you been racially discriminated in your past? It's very important, because if you become a patient, no matter, you know, under the Mental Health Act, it's very important that you know how to address that issue and that person.
Actually, Vera, that's a very important point that we don't do. But actually, because we know that this systemic racism does affect us mentally, it's actually quite a good point in terms of where we can change and asking, you know, have you been discriminated against? The answer is going to be yes, of course. But that's an important point, because that will add to the statistics. So I want to kind of talk like really upbeat now in terms of we've all got a role to play. So this is I think the difference in regards to Black Lives Matters now is that everybody's playing their role. It's not just about Black people, it's about allies coming on board and helping to make that change. So that's why it's so important to have a diverse group. And I want to say this, so what is your theme song? What is your song that uplifts you, that gets you dancing around the room, that makes you think, actually, I can conquer the world. The world is mine. I am going to conquer this world. This is going to be the world I'm going to make for your kids. What is that song? Rosemary, what's your song, Rosemary?
Oh, God. What's my
song?
I'm so eager to
say
mine.
Vera wants to say hers. Vera wants to say hers first. Vera. What's yours?
Emily.
I love it.
Where we get the talent from?
Brilliant, brilliant. Who else? What's the theme song? What's your theme song? Kimberly, what's your song?
Bob Marley, Three Little Birds.
Oh, nice. Who's gonna say Bob? Jen.
Yeah.
Jenny.
But you know what? Any Bob Marley. I just think it literally just changes. You know, I think we've non-stop been working through this period of time. So I work between three charities, and I've gone from my lovely, glamorous 3-day week for the last 3 years back into 4 to 5-day week because referrals. So every morning it's get up, get ready. I even spray perfume, do my hair, because it just changes my whole mood. Sometimes I jump on the court and everyone's like, are you all right, Jenny? Like, where are you going? I'm like, no, I need to feel good this morning because I need to feel like I'm going to work.
Yeah, I've done that. It's like, spray a bit of perfume. Only one in the house, but spray a bit of perfume. I hear you. Sandra, what's your song?
Beyonce, who runs the world? Girls.
Brilliant, brilliant.
Choice.
Yeah. Lavinia, have you said your song yet?
My song is Stevie Wonder, Higher Ground.
You have to sing a little bit of Stevie for us, Lavinia.
Good. Next time. Gonna keep on trying till I reach the highest ground.
Yeah, well done. Lovely, lovely. Rosemary, have you said yours yet?
Destiny's Child, All the Ladies.
Oh, the ladies, yeah.
I love that one. That's one of my favourites.
What's your Dawn?
So when I was younger, my dad always used to sing to me Bob Marley all the time. So he was a musician. And then the other song was Young, Gifted and Black. He used to play that every single day. And so it was just almost like, I'm young, gifted and black. No one's going to tell me any different. And then now my theme song is Labrisa Free, Something Inside So Strong. And it's just the words of that. You know, the higher they build their barriers, the taller we become. The farther they take our rights away, the faster we will run. You can deny me, you can turn your face away, no matter, because there's something inside so strong. And so it's that kind of that gets me going, especially in politics, trust me, you need that. So how about a word from everybody? So a word, could be any word, just a word that comes to mind, you know, something, I don't know, that's got you through or something that you're going to tell your kids, you know, you said like determination. Just give us some words. What are the words? What's the words?
One of the things I was able to do, like as a process of getting my head away from, not away, but to just really just be inside of myself, was to read Maya Angelou's Still I Rise book, a compilation of poetries, and it's that poem, and there was another one in there that I was just like, this is exactly what I need to remind myself of, that poem just constantly just reaffirms you know, and it fills me up. So
a few lines from that, you may write me down in history of your bitter and twisted lies. Go on, Lavinia.
But still I rise.
Still I rise. Brilliant. Love it. Who else has got some words?
I've got some words.
Kimberly.
So when I teach, these are the three attributes that I try to arm people with, is to be you, be fearless, be authentic.
I'm still amazed, Kimberly, that you, do you know what I mean, that you left your racist parents behind. I think that takes such strength and character to do that. I absolutely think that's amazing to kind of step out of that negativity and say, actually, I'm not going to be in that space and I'm going to do something else. I mean, I think that's pretty amazing. I really do. Yeah, thank you for sharing that with us. Jenni, yeah.
I said that there's a lot of strength in that, because I think even for myself, coming out of a teen DV relationship, I had to change so much things. But I think one of the things that I wanted to do was say that it stops with me. I wasn't close to my mum. My mum lives up north. So, you know, Kimberly, I know what it's like. Me and my dad do not talk and haven't for many, many years. But I've also made sure that those relationships don't change for my children. Something in me just said, this cannot continue. Need to make sure it changes. You know, when I changed my career to run my own business, I wanted to be flexible for my children so that I could be flexible for my grandchildren, because I didn't have that. But it's 10 times harder to change those and break those cycles, because you're going against everything you've learned from young. Mm-hmm. You know, all of your family's values and what everyone else says and how everyone else has grown. It's not been easy, but I'm so glad that I kind of just took that time to make sure it's got to change, all of it. I feel really good to be in the position that I'm in and built what I've built so that I can help to change the next generation and the next generation after that, that I might not even get to see, but we're doing it. And so again, Kimberly, I just commend what you've done, and it is hard work, but you will see as your children get older, the changes, I can see the changes in my children and the lives that they lead and the relationships that they have, and I'm really blessed for that.
Thank you, it's really nice to have that insight.
And breaking the cycle is not an easy thing to do. It's one of the toughest things you can ever do, is break a cycle. So Jenni, amazing that you have broken that cycle and that you are a survivor, a proper survivor, you know, in an area that nobody really talks about. So absolutely phenomenal. So thank you for sharing your story. Anybody else want to sum up, finish up?
For me, the word that stands out for me is vulnerabilities. I'm learning daily to be allowing myself to be vulnerable. When I first became a new mom, I felt like it would be the most happiest time of my entire life. And I realized quickly that it wasn't the most happiest, fullest time of my life. Actually, I had anxiety and I was afraid to let people know. My family would say, how are you doing? I'm fine. My friends, you look amazing. Thanks, I'm fine. And I hid it from so many people. So I want to encourage everybody else out there to allow yourself to be vulnerable, to be honest, without being vulnerable and speaking your truth and saying how you really feel about any circumstances, whether it be race, new parent, new motherhood. You can't get the support that you actually need. So I think we need to kind of normalize speaking out, allowing ourselves to be vulnerable, expressing any challenges that we might have with mental health or other aspects, so that we can get the support that we so rightfully need.
Yeah, yeah. Amen to that. For real.
Amen to that, yeah.
Vera, is there any last words you want to...
Yes, so I'm coming back to awareness. I would love people who listen to us to just be mindful and be aware that having trauma of discrimination will affect you in one way or another. Some people less, other people more. But there is help out there that they can address their issues and problems. Because the last thing we want for all families to be broken, and especially mothers who look after young children, and suffering in silence is very difficult. They won't be able to function fully as mothers. And last thing we want for them to turn into a different self-medicating kind of a mode of either drinking or taking drugs or trying to suppress their emotions when help is available. So we also have to talk as much as possible that there is help out there and you don't need to suffer in silence. And as Kimberly was saying, it's difficult to be isolated. And some people are, because stigma exists and it will probably be around for a very long time.
Thank you. And it's a wonderful way to end in terms of saying, you know, this is a platform for women to sort of raise their voices, to know that we're in a safe space and to know that you are all absolutely phenomenal and amazing. You know, you've broken the mold, you have broken cycles, and you are building, and you are building society that's better. And so we're having this conversation out of tragedy, but we are building something that's really powerful. And so all of the work you've been doing for time, so all, you know, it's all led us to this point so we can have this conversation. So I want to thank you all so much for sharing your stories, for us laughing. I can't wait till we all meet properly and can like have a glass of wine or something and just share. So know that you will have touched people today. You would have touched their lives that you don't even know through the screen, and you've been a comfort to people today. So
yes,
a group of women.
Thank you, Dawn, you're amazing. Thank you.
Rosemary, thank you for putting us all together. We'll see you all soon.
Bye.
Thank you, everybody. Bye. Stay safe.
Bye. Thank you, Dawn.